is the United States becoming now like Europe with open bigotry? In Europe, we're seeing legislative efforts to ban mosques, to ban burqas or veils on women. Is that where we're headed now in the United States?
Well, unfortunately, that does seem to be the direction in which we are headed. So far, we have not had similar sorts of actions like the banning of the veil and so forth. But really, that is the agenda of the people who have come out against the Islamic Community Center in downtown Manhattan. The main groups who sponsored the rally on September 11th are groups known as Stop Islamization of America, the Freedom Defense Initiative, and so forth. And the key premise, you know, behind the formation of a group like Stop Islamization of America is the idea that somehow Muslims are planning to take over the United States. The way that Pamela Geller puts it is that Muslims are attempting a political takeover, and if that doesn't work, they'll turn to intimidation, murder, and terrorism, and so forth. And so their whole agenda really is to use the tragic events of 9/11 to try to mobilize an anti-Islam, anti-Muslim agenda that will further their political goals in the upcoming elections. So we're not yet where Europe is in terms of banning, you know, headscarves and so forth, but that is the direction in which these groups want to take us.
Well, people like Newt Gingrich and Sarah Palin and right-wing intellectuals like David Horowitz have argued that the reaction to Islam is actually rational, that it's not anti-American, that it's rational because Islam is a religion that condones violence, and they cite as examples the lack of outspoken Muslim leadership after 9/11, condemning 9/11. Does that jibe with your experience of that history?
Absolutely not. There is absolutely nothing in Islam that condones violence. The term jihad, actually, you know, people should do some research about it. The term jihad that gets used as if to say jihad is a holy war against non-believers and so forth. Actually, the more important meaning of the word jihad is sort of struggle within oneself, you know, to follow the true word of God in Islam and so forth. So there's nothing, you know, about the teachings of Islam that promote violence. What you have really at work is a small handful of individuals who have formed various Islamist organizations, Islamic fundamentalist organizations, if you want to use that kind of language. And what they do is they appropriate the Quran, they appropriate Islam in certain kinds of ways to advance their own agenda. In many ways, they're very similar to, you know, our own homegrown Christian fundamentalists, you know, like the people, for instance, who were the person who was responsible for executing Dr. George Tiller, the abortion provider, you know, driven by religious fundamentalist ideas. Now, we wouldn't conclude after this, you know, atrocity took place that somehow all of Christianity is to blame or that Christians are inherently violent and so forth. And neither would we look at, for instance, the Crusades or the Inquisition and say that all Catholics are somehow bloodthirsty fanatics. And to me, it's really tragic that whereas the actions of somebody like Timothy McVeigh are seen as the actions of, you know, someone who is somewhat on the lunatic fringe, the actions of, you know, the people who belong to Al-Qaeda and so on are emblematic or representative of all 1.5 billion Muslims. And that's a travesty. It's really unjust and unfair.
You know, I was listening yesterday to a conservative intellectual on the radio who actually was very persuasive. And it was interesting because he gave a history of U.S.-Muslim relations. And his history essentially can be boiled down to this, that the Muslims picked a fight with the United States when they invaded the U.S. Embassy in Iran in 1979. And then he had a litany of escalating attacks by Muslims on U.S. interests since then. And it leaves out the part of the history. I mean, for me, it left out a critical part of that history, which was the U.S. overthrow of Mossadegh by the CIA, who was the first democratically elected leader in Iran's 4,000-year history. In 1953, the CIA overthrew him in order to protect the interests of BP. And in many ways, the invasion of our embassy in 1979 was a direct reaction to that piece of history, which is a piece of history that's remembered by every Muslim in the Mideast, but by virtually no Americans.
Absolutely. And, you know, I want to say for the record that across the globe in Muslim-majority countries, people came forward and expressed sympathy and concern for the victims and their families, and absolutely in no uncertain terms denounced the actions of Al-Qaeda. So it's not the case, you know, as the Newt Gingriches and others presented, that somehow Muslims around the world were happy when the fundamentalists carried out the attacks on 9/11. So that's the first thing, is we have to make a clear differentiation between the actions of the extremists versus the thoughts and the views of the vast majority of Muslims who hold moderate political views, or all kinds of political views, actually. Now, you raise a very important point, which is that there's a lot of history in regard to the U.S.'s interventions in the Middle East and North Africa and elsewhere, which has unfortunately been left out of mainstream media conversations. In other words, the U.S. has done things to thwart democracy in the Middle East. You know, the U.S. has been involved in these sorts of attempts, particularly during the Cold War, to prop up Islamist reactionary forces because they saw these forces as allies against the secular nationalists and against the left parties who somehow were seen as being in the camp of the Soviet Union. So there's a lot of, you know, sort of groundwork and seeds that were laid by the United States.
And that's part of the stationing of U.S. troops in Saudi Arabia was the justification that Osama bin Laden gave for his bombing of the World Trade Center.
That's exactly right.
The media actually, with the exception of Fox News, the media has been, in some cases, more responsible than they have elsewhere in terms of pointing out to people that this is not part of the American value system, that, you know, religious phobias are antithetical to what we stand for as a country. And that's something that's been helpful, hasn't it?
Absolutely. I do think that the mainstream media, as well as people like Keith Olbermann, The Daily Show with Jon Stewart and so on, have made some very useful arguments on the other side of this debate.
Do you see any parallels between what's happening today and the civil rights movement in the early 60s?
Yes, I do, because I think what we have to understand is that this attack on the Islamic Community Center is an attack on Muslims as a whole. It's a form of racism. It's Islamophobia, if you will. And really, if you think back to, you know, what was happening shortly after segregation was ended in 1953, it didn't actually go into practice. Instead, racist, you know, practices were still alive. And you think back and you know, if you go back and read what the demands by Martin Luther King and others were at that time, it was very moderate. It was simply to be treated politely. And that was just completely unacceptable to the white racist establishment in the South at that time. And you think about what Imam Rauf is trying to do. He is similarly a moderate Muslim. He is by no means a radical, either on the left or on the right. He is simply trying to build a community center where Christians, Muslims, Jews, atheists, people of all faiths can come together to better understand Islam and to better understand their neighbors who are Muslims. And now, why on earth would anybody have a problem with that unless there was a sort of deep-rooted prejudice against Muslims as a whole? And unfortunately, that's been the climate in this country since 9/11. There's been a sort of unwritten assumption, if you will, that all Muslims are to blame for the tragic events of 9/11. Unfortunately, that has been the kind of racism that Muslims have faced in this country. And I think we really have to look hard at this context. And I think if, you know, ending segregation and ending the racism that African Americans faced was a key challenge back in the 50s and 60s. Ending the racism against Muslims is our challenge today. I don't want to say that the two are the same, because racism against Muslims is not the same as the experience of the people who were brought here on slave ships. But the experience of racism and discrimination, I think, is the parallel I'm trying to draw here.